This is our massive MIMO technology. It can enhance our data rate. At the same time, it can also effectively enhance our coverage. Another one is our this channel coding and decoding technology. This is also a fundamental key technology in our mobile communications. In the early days, everyone has learned about 3G and 4G, know the encoding and decoding of the channels we use, mainly convolutional codes and turbo codes. Actually, this turbo code also has a very long history, right? Does everyone drive? It's turbocharged, right? The rest all have a T, the turbine of this turbocharged turbine. In fact, it is designed according to this turbo algorithm. Of course, our turbo here is applied in, we have entered the field of channel coding. We have a lot of technologies in channel coding, right? We have this early convolutional code, then there are also early fast encoding and so on, including our current turbo codes, polar codes, and LDPC codes. What type of channel coding should we ultimately choose? We have certain principles. Actually, we choose channel coding. We also have one for channel coding. We have another name called error correction code, right? It's about transmitting signals through wireless communication using wireless signals. When transmitting signals through wireless channels, there will be various kinds of interference. How can I effectively recover at the receiving end this original signal, the original data? Actually, it's a challenge, right? We achieve this through channel coding technology. At the beginning, I pass through the useful information, go insert a lot of what redundant bit information, enhance this information back and forth, or the correlation between bits. Then at the receiving end, I will go and decode using the corresponding code, then obtain the original information. In that case, even if I have some bits that have errors, but I added redundant bits, enhanced the correlation between these bits, I based on these correlations, I can then restore the original data. This is the value of our channel coding. However, channel coding, we see that actually they are all some, what is 0101, calculation of binary data, of data. Therefore, it has requirements for data processing, or the data processing capability might be higher. We will see when we choose channel coding, what kind of coding performance will we have. Requirements for coding efficiency and flexibility. Coding performance refers to error correction capability. Is this error correction capability high or low? Then, is the redundant data you added more or less? What we want most, it's just that I added the least amount of redundant data. At the same time, my error correction ability is very strong. But what kind of contradiction is this, right? Another point is the efficiency of encoding, right? We need to keep the complexity as low as possible. If the complexity is too high, I just need to use something more high-end. Digital signal processing chips are used to achieve this. The costs you bring will increase. At the same time, it will also bring an increase in energy consumption. So what is the efficiency of encoding? As low as possible or controllable? If the coding efficiency is too low, it may no longer have commercial application value. And another point is flexibility, right? It needs to be able to adapt to large data blocks. Also need to adapt to small data blocks, because I have some signaling. Signaling is generally small data blocks, but I have data. Again, it's another big data block. What we want most is this kind of channel, this type of channel coding. It can be applied to large data blocks. It can also be applied to small data blocks. It is very flexible. Of course, this is our basic principle for choosing channel coding. But which one should I choose? Actually, at the very beginning of the 5G coding definition, actually the main point is that there are these three coding schemes, right? One is the turbo coding, mainly promoted by the French. Of course, it is based on the original 4G turbo coding, made some enhancements. It performs some parallel processing to enhance the efficiency of turbo coding. And another one is promoted by Americans, mainly Qualcomm. The promoted LDPC coding, low density parity check code. And then there's also China, right? Polar codes promoted by China's Huawei company, Polar Code. In the end, we chose LDPC coding and polar codes. Polar code is used for control channels because the control channel mainly consists of some short codes. Polar code is more prominent in encoding performance for small packet services. Then this service channel, we have chosen LDPC coding. LDPC coding support for this type of high-speed service will be a little better. Of course, these two encodings, LDPC coding and polar code. Currently, we say it is defined regarding this data channel. We use LDPC encoding. Regarding this control channel, we use polar codes. Polar codes, but this is only limited to EMBB business scenarios. future URLLC and MMTC? What kind of channel coding should we ultimately choose? We also need to look at the R16 protocol, including the future R17 protocol. It's just the current business scenario for EMBB control, channel uses polar code, service channel uses LDPC coding. Of course, this includes a comparison of various encodings. In fact, we will see. For this kind of low speed performance, the efficiency of polar codes will be slightly better. Then for this kind of high speed large packet service, the performance of LDPC coding will be slightly better. So this is our final selection of channel coding service, channel LDPC control channel polar code. This is our channel coding technology. Another one is to enhance us, a technology for our spectrum utilization. It is F-OFDM. This is relative to the 4G era. Regarding the OFDM we use, in the 4G era, we used OFDM. Actually, it has two ends. For example, this is a 20 megahertz signal. Both ends actually have 1 trillion protection zone. So in this case, our 20 megabit bandwidth, we actually only used 18 megabytes. A 1 megabyte guard band is reserved at each end. Therefore, its spectrum utilization rate, it's only 90%. We have reserved 10% of the protection bandwidth. But in the 5G era, we are using FOFDM. The F in front means filtering. Then through FOFDM, what did we optimize in the filter? Optimized the filter, adjusted the roll-off factor of the filter, then reduce our requirements for the protective zone. In the 5G era, we use 100 megahertz. Take this carrier bandwidth as an example. We can increase the spectrum efficiency to 98.28%. We achieved this by optimizing this type of filter. This is another key technology of our 5G FOFDM. It improves spectrum efficiency. Conversely, we are within limited bandwidth. Can support higher rates now because we lowered the protective zone. Another one is the flexible frame structure. Flexible frame structure. Actually, compared to 4G, the frame structure of 4G is relatively fixed. However, the 5G frame structure is more flexible. Why is it designed with such a flexible frame structure? Primarily to adapt to different business scenarios, we view the frame structure more as a concept of the time domain. Different frame structures, we will see TTI or time slot, the sizes are different. Some time slots are 1 millisecond, some time slots are 0.5 milliseconds, some time slots are 0.25 milliseconds. It can flexibly adapt to certain business scenarios. For some, you might need low latency. For low latency, you choose this kind of thing. The subcarrier spacing is relatively large, but what about the smaller TTI cycle? If you are an ordinary business, I might choose this subcarrier spacing of 30K, that's all. Therefore, such a flexible frame structure design, mainly for adapting to what differentiated business requirements, of course, there's also one in 5G. There is also a concept called self-contained time slot when we say we are interoperable on terminals and networks. We need to send uplink data, also need to receive downlink data. But uplink and downlink, there will be a certain time lag, right? Of course, this is for the TDD system. For the FDD system, we are uplink and downlink. It is achieved through different frequency points. But for TDD, we have uplink and downlink. It is achieved through different time slots. For this type of TDD system, how can I reduce the latency between uplink and downlink? We have one in the 5G era. There is a concept of a self-contained time slot. It's just that I'm in one time slot. What? Do I have downlink? There is also a protective interval. There is also uplink in this way. I can fit within one time slot. Complete the reception of downlink data and feedback on what data I passed. Hark. Did I actually receive it? Still not received. I am able to demodulate normally. Still unable to demodulate normally. Right? If you have received it, you just demodulated normally. You just replied with a hark, right? Tell the network that I have received it normally. If you do not demodulate it properly, then you just send back a NAC. The network can retransmit it. In that case, we will find out what time slot am I in. Just receive the downlink data and what uplink feedback, hark feedback all achieved. Then what can I do? Effectively reduce latency. This self-contained time slot can be applied in such low latency scenarios. But we have uplink and downlink. However, it's relatively difficult to implement. because we need to do it in a very short time. For example, our terminal in the downlink scenario, the terminal needs to operate within a very short time, demodulate the data. At the same time, we need to immediately switch to the uplink transmission state. This will place very high demands on the terminal. So currently, self-contained slot, we have not applied. It might be in subsequent versions, go to implement. It's just that the difficulty is still relatively high at the moment. We have this concept now, but it will be implemented later. Of course, self-contained time slot, mainly used to reduce latency, good. This is our air interface in 5G. Some of these key technologies were used. We have massive MIMO. We have such an advanced modulation method. There is this highly efficient coding method and also our self-contained time slots, flexible frame structure. We have a lot of these new technologies to improve our spectrum efficiency, to enhance our speed, to reduce our bandwidth. Of course, we still have two questions here. The first question is, we have many frequency bands in 5G, right? We will have this kind of sub-3G low frequency. There will be such a C-band. We will also have some millimeter waves in the future. We have different frequency bands like this. What are their typical application scenarios, right? What is our low frequency mainly used for? What is the C-band mainly used for? Then millimeter wave. What kind of scenarios can it be applied to in the future? This is our first question. Second question, it's what we just introduced. Many key technologies of air interface, which technologies do we have in here? It can enhance the speed of 5G and briefly explain the reason we introduced massive MIMO. We introduced F-OFDM. What can be done to improve 5G speed? Briefly explain the reason for this. Good. These are our two questions. Everyone can on our platform. Then go answer this question for us. That's all for today's content regarding these two questions. Everyone can answer on our platform. Good. Thank you, everyone.